You're watching Fanboy Versus with your hosts, JD Church, Nicole Hale, Chris Triplett, and Chris McFeely.
And you are watching Fanboy Versus. I'm your host, JD. Joined this week by the full crew, yay! Chris Triplett, Chris McFeely, Nicole Hale, yay!
I didn't hear the theme music. What happened?
Take a drink, yay! I don't know.
Oh God, I messed up the game this whole time.
I know. People have it. That's like the semi-guaranteed drink, you know? Everybody's like, aw.
Well, I would have been here, but I was like off in the future fighting Sentinels trying to save the mutants from, right, you know, extinction.
Right.
I came back with a scar across my face, but I had it healed by somebody.
Right. I guess that's better than being in the future and sending your thoughts to the past in order to save the... I don't know how that's supposed to work, but apparently it was a good series. So,
dude, Wolverine and X-Men was awesome. Shut up.
I'm not saying it wasn't. I'm just saying I don't understand the premise. That's all I'm saying. If you just said it was like Wolverine leading the mutants and there was no Professor and Scott and stuff around, cool, I'm there. But, you know, I don't know. Anyway, sending your thoughts into the past. So, is Fanboy Versus, holy crap, Transformers comics are awesome. There is little doubt probably in your minds that we will be talking about More Than Meets the Eye at the end of this broadcast, because holy crap.
We'll probably do a lot of talking about it.
It's a mind-blowing issue. That's all I can tell you. So we'll get there. But anyway, so since we got a lot of stuff and we got Chris Triplett back, let's just get to it then. So first, Chris McFeely, news, what we got going on?
Oh, it's kind of quiet this week, but there's a couple of bits and pieces. On the movie front, Latino Review this week, they say they have the story. You know, it's still not officially confirmed by any official parties. They're saying this is to be expected to be confirmed by Marvel at SDCC, confirming the already existing rumor that Guardians of the Galaxy is going to be the second Marvel film for 2014.
Huh. Yep.
So what are they going to... But that begs the question. I mean, so what does that mean? I mean, what are they going to do? What's it going to be? I mean, who's going to be in it? What, you know?
Rocket Raccoon, yeah.
All discussion.
Yeah, exactly. Grim.
One would presume, in all seriousness, that it'll be the version of the Guardians that we just saw in the Avengers cartoon a little while ago. Adam Warlock, Gamora, Groot, Rocket Raccoon, and Star-Lord. Yep. Maybe give or take, either way. The modern version of the Guardians.
So,
like, I'm not sure what I think about that, personally. I have no particular attachment to either group of Guardians, but these guys did just rip the name off of the original guys, who were the real Guardians. They were doing it before it was cool.
They don't have Rocket Raccoon.
Okay, this version is in the present, right? Because like, the other version is in the future.
From the future. Yes, that was also said in the future. But they often came back in time to have hijinks in the present day.
So they know a lot about the past, then.
Yes, because it's an alternate future.
Oh, well then. So they're from the future and they don't even know anything about the past. That's
I just remember that Justice from like New Warriors was there and he had Cap Shield or something, right? Something weird with that. That was just crazy.
Well, that was where he first appeared. That's where Vance Astro first appeared, was as an astronaut who was sent into space and trapped in suspended animation and revived in the 31st century. And
oh, Buck Rogers.
Yeah, basically.
Yeah. Okay.
And then, many moons later, they introduced the young present-day version of Vance Astro from before that would ever happen to him, and he was Justice of the New Warriors.
Yep. Huh.
Yeah.
So is this basically going to be, Marvel's attempt within the new comic framework, within the new comic movie framework, Iron Man and Captain America?
The cinematic universe.
In this new context, to do a team movie out of the gate, like an X-Men or something like that, where it's like this is meant to be a team and we're just going to do it on the first shot.
One would also assume that this is building on the Thanos thing.
Well, and that's the thing that comes after that. I mean, we assume that this end of the Avengers thing was tying into the next Avengers movie, but
Yeah,
this would seem to indicate that this is more leading into maybe the Guardians movie.
Well, you think about it, the other Marvel movies, you know, Hulk and Iron Man and Thor, they all somehow interlink together. So maybe this is going to be like another way that they're going to interlink.
I mean,
Thanos.
I couldn't really see any of the other Avengers. I couldn't see. Well, next year we get Iron Man 3 and Thor 2. And then 2014 is Cap 2 and apparently Guardians of the Galaxy. And I can't really see either of those other three doing anything with Thanos. And I also can't see them leaving Matt to dangle with no build-up for 2 years, 3 years.
Yeah.
But the they probably realize a lot of people didn't know who that was at the end of the credits there, so they need to introduce Thanos so that he could look like a threat, you know. And plus, the whole story with him and death—that's kind of a big story in the whole Infinity Gauntlet.
That
means
they won't dig into any of that.
They're going to go cosmic with it, with the Guardians of the Galaxy. You never know. It's really, frankly, if we're getting a Guardians of the Galaxy movie, I really don't think you can say, "Oh, they're not going to do that."
That's true.
Silly.
Fair enough.
Guardians of the friggin' galaxy.
Yeah, that is sort of no holds barred, you know. Anything's on the table.
How much money do they think that could potentially make? I mean, are they banking on Star Trek? Because Star Trek was, like, really, really popular, like, that reboot. And maybe they're thinking, oh, we can take away something from that, or I don't know.
I mean,
It does seem like an actively odd choice.
Well, I think
it's because Marvel has such a good name right now on movies that people will go see it because they want to see a good movie made. So,
well, and
okay,
and I mean,
okay, who wants to make bets on whether or not we're getting a Sleepwalker movie next?
Oh, yeah.
What?
I would pay to see that.
That's a pretty good film premise as well.
Yes, it is.
I mean, you got to work with it a little. Maybe he wouldn't be dressed in purple leg warmers. It's not 1991 anymore. But, you know, solid premise there in Sleepwalker, I think.
Wow. Okay.
Sticking with the Marvel movie business, another surprising story that came out was also from the Teen Review. This is all alleged again, but this makes a perturbing amount of sense, is that Marvel could have a third film in 2014, but it would not be a live-action one.
There's rumor
now of a possible animated Marvel movie, animated by Disney, of course, because...
Disney?
Well, Disney. Big Hero 6.
What?
Yes, exactly.
Really?
Yes. Those guys
that showed up in my Spider-Man comic that I didn't know anything about?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, that would, A, explain that. B, explain why their own original miniseries is being collected later this year. And that's it. A and B.
That's really all you need, right? I mean,
explain these very odd choices. I'm actually going to pick that up and say you should pick it up too, because it's by Chris Claremont, so yeah, good. It was originally solicited as a trade paperback, but it got pulled, you know, the pre-sales on it must have been terrible. But now it's being resolicited as just like a soft cover, like a comic cover, like a paper cover, just an ordinary fat comic. $8, 5 issues.
Okay. I can probably do that.
It's a couple of months away, but it's like if you want to see who Marvel's next animated superstars might be.
These are like wonky choices. I mean, come on, guys. What's up with this?
Yeah, where's my Doctor Strange movie?
Exactly. Where's my Doctor Strange?
Okay. That. Did I mention who my suggestion for who should play Doctor Strange in a live action film?
Who was that?
Charlie Sheen.
Oh no. Okay. Right.
Come on. I mean,
I hadn't heard about this, but some customers told me about this a couple of weeks ago, and when they told me, I just sort of stopped and went, that'd be fantastic. And apparently, like this was a rumor going around, Benedict Cumberbatch from Sherlock.
Oh,
that would be fantastic. He can do no wrong in my book right now. So yes, he can do that.
Can't
I'll
you
okay
see it
that
in your mind brain though? Just imagine a little mustache. Slick
but we
hair.
But we all know who it really is going to be. It's going to be Nicolas Cage.
No. I would reach down my own throat and pull out my heart.
By the
he already had his chance as a superhero.
I just watched Ghost Rider Spirit of Vengeance like yesterday, so that's why I'm totally thinking it's going to be Nick Cage.
I think we need to check in. Why would you watch that on your own choice?
I you know what? I didn't hate it. I'll say that.
It's on my list of stuff to watch this summer, but wow.
Get something through Netflix. So I was like, hey, you know, that's out. Let's do this. Let's do it. I got it.
Is it on Netflix now?
DVD, not streaming.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, that's not the same.
Well, no. There you go.
Huh. There
you go. Yep. Also, it was confirmed this week that Edgar Wright has shot a test reel for Ant-Man as well.
Really?
Hey.
Yes. I mean, now that doesn't necessarily mean anything because he's busy working on, or he will be, before the end of the year, he will be working on the third Simon Pegg and Nick Frost movie in their Cornetto trilogy. After, what's it called, Shaun of the Dead and Hot Fuzz, the third one of those. But it's still there, you know, he's not, I mean, this was something that was a while back, you know, the idea for this happened, and it was a part of their original slate back in 2006, actually, and then it was dropped as they started building up to the Avengers, but obviously Wright hasn't forgotten about it, so stuff is still happening there, and if Guardians of the Galaxy can have a film, I don't know.
I mean, you know, but at one time we were talking about a Deadpool movie happening, and, you know, and that's...
I've said it before, though, that I think the Deadpool movie has... The Deadpool bubble popped, and that movie is no longer particularly feasible.
No.
The comic even... Is it even published anymore? I have no idea.
I think
Deadpool is still published.
I think it's down to, what, two comics now?
Just the one.
Only
just one, wow.
Okay. All I know is that Deadpool was in a musical, a Broadway musical, not that far...
Everything
not that long ago.
Everything's in a Broadway musical. Or at least a musical. Wow. So, no, I mean, I'm not surprised by that. But, you know, I guess it's more of the deal where it's like, if things are far enough out, you know, if it's not in production, it's not, you know, nothing set in stone. So.
No, I mean, I don't really know why they feel that Ant-Man needs a film to build him up for the Avengers. It seems to me he's a better choice to introduce in the context of an Avengers film.
Yeah.
Yes.
But we shall see.
So, but which Ant-Man are we going to get? Are we going to get the one that we somewhat like in the cartoon or the one that's kind of abusive in the comics?
Well, the rumor, again, this is back when, like, was that it would be split across two time periods. Focusing on Hank Pym as the original Ant-Man while casting Scott Lang in a modern-day Ant-Man.
Looks like that'd be kind of confusing, though, for like a person that's not familiar with it.
Yeah, that would seem odd.
Okay. It's like, you already got to convince him that a guy can shrink down to like the size of an ant. Maybe that's a little bit too much, you know?
Yes, he can talk to ants, and he's crazy, and he can get big, too.
They need to do the giant man thing. That's really... That's where it's at.
In the world of actual comics news, Marvel began dropping these teaser images this week, which showed us various like images, imagery of defeated Avengers. Thor's hammer on the ground, Captain America's shield dripping with blood, bullet holes in Iron Man's faceplate, and Spider-Man with a gun to his neck, Wolverine's hand on fire, and Black Widow in some crosshairs with the tagline, "This is war." And I think most... God. Most people thought this was going to be, when we saw the Thor and the Cap and the Iron Man trailers, and that this was going to be the Ultron War.
No.
It's not.
I am shocked.
Yes. October 2012, Punisher Warzone.
Oh.
What?
Is it Punisher versus the universe or the universe again or something? Or was that comic? He killed Punisher kills the Earth or something? I don't know.
Punisher kills the Marvel universe.
Yeah, that's what it was.
Did someone at Marvel forget that Punisher isn't relevant anymore?
Hey, Greg Rucka's Punisher.
Hey, Greg Rucka's comic is awesome. You shut your face.
I mean,
yes, four people are loving that comic. But
hey, it's awesome. Hey.
Leave Punisher alone. I don't think this is a new series or anything. They have revealed no details on it, simply that it's Punisher Warzone October 2012, and there are 5 weeks in October, so I'm thinking it's a weekly five-issue miniseries. And not any kind of event, as a lot of people have jumped
to. Wake me up when it's over.
You know, that doesn't disturb me as much as the fact that Gambit's getting an ongoing series. What?
I know.
What?
Right?
Again?
I, like, opened Amazing Spider-Man and saw the craziest freaking ads. Hawkeye ongoing yeah, series, yeah. The first X-Men, Gambit.
The first X-Men looks pretty interesting, though.
So yeah, all that stuff that we said about Marvel finally getting it and trimming down the fat and, like...
We talked about Hawkeye and Gambit's ongoing series like a month or two ago.
Yeah.
Remember how bitches
like,
love Gambit?
Seen it in an ad? Seen it in an ad.
Well, Hawkeye doesn't surprise me. It's got a really good creative team who previously did really good work on it together. Coming off the back of the film, I mean, admittedly, it is the sixth attempt at giving Hawkeye an ongoing series out of the last 4 years. But yeah, well, okay, it's not an ongoing series. But maybe, yeah. It's the sixth number one over series.
Some characters just don't do good outside of a team. Some characters are just fun and funny.
Just
when
as
they're
long
doing
as they don't
thing.
Give him that horrible 90s costume.
I can't see anybody like in a boardroom justifying a new Gambit ongoing series.
Yeah, that's the weird one.
Okay, you have a vagina. You don't get a vote.
What we need is more bitches reading comics, is what this guy said. He had just a flip chart, and it was like, bitches, and they flipped it over, and it was like, Gambit. And it was like, that is thought process
bitches,
that got that comic
it's
on the
like,
show.
One page says, bitches, next is a plus sign, next is Gambit, next is dollar signs.
Yeah. Next is Gambit movie starring Ryan Reynolds, because he's not dead.
No.
You gotta get who's the guy that did 21 Jump Street and just did the Magic Mike? Channing Tatum. There you go. Have him play Gambit. Money in the bank.
Oh man, can you conceive of Channing Tatum trying to do an accent of any kind?
Oh, there would be no accent. They would totally go storm with that.
And it's like, what do you mean? I'm talking with an accent, Mon Cherie.
You know what? They would say, that's great. Just take your shirt off. It'll be all fine. If you just take your shirt off, no one will notice that you're not speaking with
me. Doesn't have a tendency of going around shirtless very often.
He would in the movie.
All in one bodysuit.
He would in the Channing Tatum movie, that's for sure.
Well, you just wait till August and I'll review it.
Can somebody erase my memories of the last, like, 15 minutes? I don't want to do this anymore.
No, sir. No. You have to carry that pain around with you.
I need a brand new day just for my life where, like, Chris, the last 15 minutes didn't happen.
Chris Triplett's like, why did I come back to this show? I could have just, been gone.
He's a beautiful man. Do not talk bad about him. You have a Punisher. I have my Gambit. How's that?
I don't want either. What the hell? What am I supposed to do?
Kind of
incredible. God. You read Scarlet Spider. That's what you do.
That's it. I do have. This is where I get the hate mail because I dropped like FF and Fantastic Four, but I made sure to keep my Scarlet Spider. That's for sure.
That makes no sense.
I know, doesn't it? No. I stayed on for the Hickman run. I feel good. I feel done. I wasn't a huge Fantastic, Four fan before, so I kind of just reconciled it with myself and said, okay, the big story is over. I'm good.
Well, I guess.
Yeah, I know. It was hard, but stuff had to go. So, any other news? We said something about Detective, I think, before the show.
Yes, Tony Daniel has announced he's leaving Detective Comics as well. I'm sure there's one person in a hut somewhere crying about it, but I'm not.
Why?
Hey, that first issue was pretty good. It's
he
just
got the face off of Joker.
It was, actually. He really brought his A-game to that first issue.
One issue.
I don't know what happened from 2 to 10, but number 1 was pretty good.
I know what happened from 2 to 10. Tony Daniel kept writing them. It's like, who the hell decided Tony Daniel could go up against Scott Snyder? Like,
I heard that Scott Lobdell is going to be taking over.
I heard it was Ralph.
No, I don't. I'm sure it'll be Brian Azzarello. So.
Okay, let's see. Scott Lobdell takes over, so who can the destroy in the Batman universe? Trying to
who
think.
What?
So, yeah, okay, like Scott Lobdell did the thing where Starfire was like a hooker or something. So who can that turn to?
It's like a hooker. Oh, that's awesome. Oh, God.
I don't think they need to. They've got Catwoman in there already.
Yeah, really. I think they've done they've done a number on
there.
On all of that. Wow. Okay, cool. Well, I do want to mention real quick, before we get into the rest of the show, because I assume that's all the news. Yes, that's...
Yeah, that's everything.
So, San Diego Comic-Con is coming up. Weekend of, and now we can't hear Nicole. So, no.
I was just asking if you could still talk about Gambit.
You can take up all of your recommendation time talking about Gambit if you would like.
In August, I will.
Okay.
Hey, you roll to the drink game whenever Gambit's mentioned. Take a drink.
Yeah, you have to take your shirt off and then take a drink if you're a guy. It's like, if you're a girl, you throw your panties. I don't know. Anyway. coming up, weekend of July the 14th is San Diego Comic-Con. Oh, my God. Oh, and we're hoping for big announcements for all kinds of stuff, coming up, the Guardians of the Galaxy thing. We've talked about a lot of stuff that, should be coming up. Not just movie, hopefully, but comic news as well. Events and things that may be coming up. So it's going to be big, but we are planning as a TF Radio Network thing. July 14th, we'll have our big broadcast. So I will be there. I'm pretty sure Brian Kilby will be there. Other people may be in and out during the day, special guests. We don't know. Be sure to join us for that. Tune in, get more information. We'll be posting it, of course, on the website, Twitter, Facebook, all that stuff. But just to kind of give you an early FYI. Not really early. It's like 2 weeks away. So,
mm-hmm.
Anyway, there you go. So, excellent. All right. It is time then for our recommendations of the week.
Ooh.
Yes. And to start us off is a man that has not been here and hasn't even done a recommendation yet. So he'll have no context for it whatsoever. But we're going to throw it to him anyway, is Chris Triplett.
I probably don't even have to do a recommendation because
we already know
what I'm gonna
get your shot glasses ready. Is there any
doubt?
For God's
sakes, I mean, Amazing Spider-Man is awesome. Of course, I'm going to recommend it. And Amazing 688 is great. And if you're going to go see that movie that you may have heard about coming out Tuesday, hey,
nope,
this issue's got the lizard in it.
Woohoo! Yeah.
Well, there you go. You can, before you go see it, you can read this issue because it's got the lizard in it. And hey, it's a pretty good issue.
Yeah, I mean, you should, especially in referencing that, you should all go see it because it'll be out this week and then we'll probably end up talking about it.
Yeah, that's going to be next week's thing. Should be.
Yeah.
So
you didn't get it early? McFeely, you
didn't
get it early?
No, not this year. Not this movie, no. But it is out here on Tuesday as well. So.
Okay, well, that's good.
I will have it seen by next week, so that'll be our top of the show next week, I'm sure.
I just looked at the Gambit ad. Everyone loves a good score. Oh, my God.
I know. I'll tell you what, though. Wait. The solicit for Gambit number 2 is actually really playing along with the joke, because the solicit, it goes through, whatever all is happening. Gambit does X, Gambit does Y, and then the third bullet point is, special bonus, Belladonna does not appear anywhere in this issue.
Oh, my God. Wow.
I thought you were going to say the ad was going to sound like, hurry up and get Gambit number 2 before it gets canceled.
No, but it's really riffing on how rubbish Gambit and his whole supporting cast are. It's bonus. Stupid things not in this.
Surprise.
Well, no, to be fair, James Asmus is a good writer.
I have no idea who that creative team is, so maybe they will make it good.
I'm pretty sure I'll love it.
But yeah, since I don't know how you guys want me to do recommendations, all I can say is, hey, it's good. I don't want to talk about it.
Can you tell us a little about it.
Hey, the lizard comes back, and Spidey basically has to finally take him down. He's been kind of in the sewers for a while, and situations come up where he may be able to finally cure him, get Kurt Connors back.
Hey, that's story I've ever read. What's different about this one?
What's different is, do we want Kurt Connors back? That's the thing you should be thinking about. Because some crazy stuff is going down. Yes.
Okay, because I've just barely started reading Spider-Man. What is Mary Jane and Carly's relationship?
They are
exes and they can talk about Peter. Okay. Because
it is the worst. All right, I can tell you this from experience. The worst possible thing that could happen to you. There's two things. Okay, when you have two ex-girlfriends, or especially when you have a current ex-girlfriend and, or you know, a recent ex-girlfriend and a current girlfriend, when they meet, one of two very horrible things will happen. Either they will absolutely hate each other, and they will be very petty, and they will say petty, horrible things to each other.
And the worst thing is they actually like each
other.
The
worst possible thing is that they get along. Peter is in the worst possible position right now, because now he's got two of his ex-girlfriends, one of them he's still really good friends with, and they apparently get along really well.
And well, there's a story awful. You could never have told with a married Spider-Man.
Yeah.
I didn't know if those two were in a relationship, you know.
Oh, no.
Sexually.
No, no, no. They're, no. No, no, no. I mean, I don't want to rule anything out, but I don't think so. I think this is just...
It is Dan Slott, so he does know how to throw a curveball, so I would not completely...
But I don't see him as the kind to just throw in a relationship just for fun. I mean, that would be reading a lot of, you know, MJ and Carly.
Well, see, like
Carly.
I said, I've only been recently reading Amazing Spider-Man for, what, 3 months now, so I wasn't sure.
Yeah, but no, Peter is in a really horrible position, because I read that and I went, oh. Because there was this one time I was dating a girl... And then I was still friends with, like, my ex-girlfriend, and I put them in the same place. And it was very bad, because they really got along well. And it also happened to be at, like, my parents', anniversary renewing their vows thing. So it was at a church.
Was there, like, a large chocolate fountain that happened to get knocked over at some point?
No, this was more them talking and then comparing notes, like, as we're sitting next to the pastor of my parents' church.
And some of the food got ruined, so somebody had to, like, quickly order takeout in for everybody, but secretly, so nobody would find out. And then Frasier and Niles had a terrible talk.
That would be great too. Anyway, I'm sorry. Amazing Spider-Man was amazing, right? That's what you're...
Yeah, it's great and it's awesome. And with just a quick little mention, I also want to say Spider-Man, the miniseries, Michael Bendis, you know, Peter Parker, Miles Morales, it's good. Get it? I mean, and just, you know, without you saying anything about it, it actually, number two, makes me feel like this is not just, hey, they're just teaming up. There's actual stuff. Like, I mean, have you read it, McFeely?
I read it. I got it here.
The stuff with Mysterio, that's actually something that plays into Ultimate Spider-Man. I mean,
it's not a random thing. Like, this has build-up. This has, although, you know, you wouldn't have known it was build-up at the time. And I'm not 100% sure if it was written as build-up at the time, but it's definitely paying off and resolving a mystery that's been floating around the Ultimate Spidey books for a while. Mind you, I still think that it's going... about it a little backward, because for the Mysterio thing, I suppose it has to go this way, but when it's Peter visiting the Ultimate Universe, Peter's already done alternate timelines and alternate dimensions and things. This is all a bit old a hat to him, and he basically figures out that's what's going on, and it's all right, okay, on with the things then. It seems like it would make a lot more sense to dump Miles in the mainstream universe and have a character who has never had to deal with that sort of thing take it from that side. And
that makes sense, but then the Mysterio thing probably wouldn't work if you did that, though, because it makes more sense the way they're doing it.
But then it's like, how far are they going with Mysterio? Because it's like, you know, when you're putting Peter into an outrageous situation like this, even though it's one that he's basically familiar with the workings of, they could have played it off as him not believing any of it because it's friggin' Mysterio, you know?
Who's to say that Peter's just going to be in the Ultimate Verse and that they're not going back to the Marvel Universe before the end of it?
It would be a terrible crime if they didn't get Miles into the mainstream universe.
Miles didn't show up in the mainstream. Yeah, I think that's where they're going with it. And it's cool. I really like it. I mean, it's I didn't know what to think about it because I thought it was just going to be kind of like a quick cash grab. It's actually entertaining. I've enjoyed it. Boy, the art's gorgeous.
Dude. Oh, yeah. Sarah Pacelli on the creative team. I mean, it just seems like the Mysterio thing is there more to tie in with a dangling Ultimate Spidey plot thread and not used to the fullest that the potential for employing Mysterio in. You know, it's a story where Spider-Man is thrown into an unfamiliar scenario with a lot of unbelievable concepts. And it at no point riffs on the idea that he might think Mysterio is trying to trick him with a massive hallucination, you know, and it's like, it's friggin' Mysterio, you know?
Yeah. And it's just weird because, like, where does the Ultimate Universe go post this series? I mean, is there going to be a revolving door now? You know, I mean, what's going to happen? Up.
Well, we'll be fine after this.
Miles won't even remember it happened.
Oh, yeah. Well, no, I wonder if Miles might get web shooters out of this deal.
Oh, that's he right. Doesn't have webbing any or anything, does he?
No, Miles doesn't have web yet.
Hmm.
Peter's going to make him web shooters. That would be awesome. Yeah, I'm all for that.
Web.
Huh. Cool. Awesome. You did good, Triplet.
Yeah.
That was good. See?
Thank you.
He's got the recommendation thing down. He hasn't even done it before.
Look at that. Look at him go there. Look at that boy.
It's like he's a broadcasting professional. Nicole, then, what do you have?
Going on to someone that's not professional.
Whatever.
Go on to me.
Shut up. You're on more podcasts than all of us combined.
I don't. This doesn't mean I know what I'm doing.
Uh-huh.
Anyways, my first recommendation is going to be Aquaman, because it's a series that I think more people need to start reading. Or
yes.
Actually, one of the DC comics that I'm still reading after the new reboot, you know. And this one has the classic Black Manta versus Aquaman team up build up. And then if you're watching the Young Justice cartoon, you kind of get the sense of Aqualad as well in here. So, and his relationship to Black Manta.
Young Justice, why? Just why?
It is getting better. I just about dropped it because I'm just like, I cannot stand to see another Megan and Connor episode.
You never have to see one again, do you?
So the second season's a lot better. But if you kind of like what that cartoon is going off of, you know, with Aqualad and Black Manta, this is a good start to pick up is issue number 10. So you can see the big rivalry. So
there's definitely an interesting new twist added to their backstory with this one.
There is, and I don't want to spoil it. So, and
I haven't read that issue yet. So yeah, okay. Don't spoil it, but I'm glad that it's still good because I'm a little bit behind in Aquaman. Yes.
And there is a 2-page splash page of Black Manta and Aquaman that is just absolutely gorgeous.
You know,
Does he cut his hand off?
No, it's
so bad.
Oh, well, never mind then.
It's just, you know, a beautiful, beautiful splash page, and the art's just wonderful. It's very.
There's no question that the art is great, but you know what? Somebody kind of pointed this out to me, and now I can't read Aquaman without noticing it anymore. I mean, I had already noticed it already anyway, but it's just, it seems to be getting worse with each passing issue, which is the masturbation of the artist, the way the entire book is written around giving the artist as many big, big things to draw at all. It's like we are now 3 chapters into the other, and Mera is still standing in the same room. And Aquaman, I believe, has probably been about 4 fucking pages of the thing and thrown one punch. It's like, cut to the bastard chase with this story.
No, the story is picking up here, trust me.
It is picking up 3 parts in, and it's probably only 5 parts long. And I'm like, what happened to searching for the mystery behind the sinking of Atlantis? Again, I thought that's what this story was supposed to be about. And notice how every goddamn page has the same layout of a load of vertical panels, the full width of the page stacked on top of one another.
Occasionally,
there's a couple of thin ones. But it's either that or like a couple of thin panels then across the top or the bottom stacked horizontally.
I think it's a little better in this issue.
A little better, but there's one.
I see what you're talking about. I do see what you're talking about, though.
The story is definitely there, but I'm not getting enough of it. It's testing my patience. It's lovely to look at, but really it is being written in such a way as to, like, go light on story and big on explosive, impressive images.
Is that like how Johns did Hawkman? Like, you know, Hawkman's stuff kind of interesting, and then he just kind of, you know, it didn't go anywhere.
I never read it, so I don't know.
Yeah. I do wish they would do something with Mera, though. I agree with you there. She just seems to. She's a very powerful person. They need to use her more. So.
She, I mean, right now, like, she's just getting exposition from this Dr. Shin, who's this character that Johns has been building up since his run started. And I'm like, I know we're learning more about this guy, but it's like, one time he did a bad thing, and that's it. And like, I feel like we're really, really dancing around this. The plot of this is the Black Manta is hunting down and killing all the members of a team that Aquaman used to be on in his early days, and they're all charged with safeguarding what appear to be ancient Atlantean artifacts, and he's killing them and recovering the artifacts. And like, that's all
it's
that's happening.
It's kind of almost like Transformers Prime-ish.
But with less character.
Wow.
Ouch. You're like nearly knocking Jeff Johns in, aren't you?
It's just, you know, I mean, the twist with the Black Manta, it's like, basically all, it's actually just coalesced. This is what it is. It's all big, splashy action. Anything that's not action is about fiddling with history and the lore of Aquaman, introducing this new team, introducing this new twist on this relationship with Black Manta. It's like, it's all about the lore. It's not a story. It's a story about a story. It's up its own arse about the lore of Aquaman. Though. Like, Jones's Green Lantern is the same. It took a while before it really solidified that that's what it was about, but it was about after Sinestro Corps War, which is the last truly fantastic thing Jones did on Green Lantern. Every subsequent story was about the cosmology of Green Lantern and adding another ring color. And it's like when we got to Blackest Night and we thought it was all over, it was like, no, now Crona's back and he's gathering up all of the elemental energies. More stories about the lore and the cosmology of Green. Could I not just have a story where Aquaman does some stuff instead of, and you know, he spends the what is practically the B plot of the issue punching Black Manta around while two people stand in a room and explain to us why his history is different now and why we should care.
Hey, McPhilly, hey, they did an issue where he was in the desert.
That was, that was awesome. Because yes, yes. That was literally, I think
that's all I got to say.
You know, whenever I'm feeling down or blue, I just imagine fish by the tons full jumping up onto the shore somewhere. Trying to get to Aquaman in the middle of a desert.
That was an episode that was actually about Aquaman struggling with something, and whenever they added the plot-based twist at the end with the projection that started playing, it was about kicking off a mystery that was going to start a mystery that they haven't expanded on in the slightest, like the mystery of who really sank Atlantis, which is what they present. You know, it's like, Black Manta will never be very good ever, really. It's just Black Manta. You know, you're going to have to really reinvent Black Manta on the same level as you've tried to reinvent Aquaman before I'm going to care about Black Manta.
They would have to do with Black Manta what they did with Sinestro and really...
Black
I'm thinking that's what they're going for with the storyline, though.
Yes, yeah, there is some new stuff dropped into his backstory here that does intrigue, you know? Mm-hmm. But... yeah, it's gonna have to pull its socks up very quickly.
I'm still enjoying this it.
This story has flagged the others. The others has flagged for me.
But okay, my next review though is what I'm so excited to talk about. I'm talking about Marvel Zombies Destroy again. Yes, I know, because this one was probably my second favorite comic this week, next to Transformers. basically, Loki's a bastard. Huge bastard.
yeah.
Gosh. Okay, so it's going to kind of be a little spoilerish. I have to if I want to talk about it. So basically, Loki's the one that brought on the zombie apocalypse because he wanted to trick Thor into coming to Earth because he's not supposed to be on Earth. So he wanted Thor to get in trouble either by leaving Earth or to torture him by seeing Earth be destroyed. So... well, it kind of backfired, but it's even better for Loki because Odin decided to come down and see what was going on. But Odin's weakened right now because he's in the Odin sleep. And Odin's the one that got bit. Let's just say that.
Oh,
what happens?
Zombie Odin.
Yeah. Well, the thing is, think about it. All Asgardians are interconnected to the All-Father. So, hence, he becomes a zombie, the virus spreads, and whole all of Asgard is a zombie now, and that's why they're after Loki, because he's the one Asgardian that still hasn't changed. Well, because he's not fully Asgardian. He's adopted, right? So they're all after Loki. That's why it's coming. And this is just the first four pages, people.
Wow.
Pretty cool.
Yeah. So just with that, you've got to, I mean, if you have a favorite Asgardian, they're in here and they're zombified. And the way that they talk is so fun. I mean, Volstagg isn't the voluptuous. He's the vomitous.
Quick question.
Wow.
Who's writing Marvel Zombies now? I mean, who's the writer on it?
This is... Where is it at? It's in the middle of the page. It is Peter David.
Peter David's writing this.
Really? Peter David's doing it. Things. Okay.
Yeah.
Awesome. So,
that does make a lot of sense.
I should be reading this.
This is so much fun. This issue alone, like I said, what I just told you was in the first four pages. And so... You get Thor talking in his, you know, majestic way, but with kind of like an evil twist. So you see that. You see Dum-Dum Dugan, one of my favorites now. He's trying to get away, so he dresses up as a zombie so he can work his plan. It's just so much fun, this issue. I'm not kidding. But Loki's a bastard, and I still love him for it. Because he's just like, I wasn't planning this, and it worked out even better, but now he's suffering because they're all after him. That's why, so the whole, everyone from Asgard is basically on their way to Earth zombified. Two thumbs up for me.
Wow. I kind of want to read it now that you said Peter David, because I've been jonesing for something about Peter David.
Is Howard the Duck still in this? Is that?
Yes, he is. Cool. Howard is, he's still one of the ones that survived.
Did you see, or has any of you seen this video that Joe Quesada made, that Marvel had made, where they were like, it was sort of like a joke petition to have George Lucas release the rights so that they could do like a anniversary edition of Howard the Duck? It was hilarious. They did it with
was
like,
this the Blu-ray release thing? Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah,
I heard something about that.
Yeah, they were wanting to do a Blu-ray release for the anniversary of Howard the Duck and trying to get, you know, Schmooze Lucas. And I think there's even a part where, like, Joe Quesada offers to personally give him, like, a very odd amount of money, like $1,286.42, you know? Like, it's funny. It's on YouTube. You should check it out. But there's a lot of... like figure animation that's in that as well with Howard the Duck. But anyway, because he talks about being the first comic book movie, major like comic book character movie. But anyway, it's funny. Cool.
Let's look that up.
Yes. So go read this because this issue was so much fun. I loved it. If you're a fan of the Asgardians, it's a must.
Nice.
I wonder if we're going to get a Marvel zombie movie for getting Guardians of the Galaxy, because I would pay to see
A Marvel zombie movie? Maybe an animated.
I would pay to see
You know, they should do that as an R-rated animated film. That would be
To see that, too.
That would be the way to do that. I mean, because then you don't have to worry about effects and, you know, confusion, any of that. You just do it as an animated special, that, you know, like the DVD release. That would be awesome.
Yeah, I mean, if Marvel could get on that, that would be the perfect thing to do, really, because, I mean, so many of Marvel's direct-to-DVD things, we've said it before, like, way back when it came out, Planet Hulk is still the only one they've managed that's a DC quality type thing.
Yeah,
you know?
That's really good.
Yeah.
And because everything else is just, they're basically original stories. Aside from the Ultimate, the first Ultimates one, like Thor, Hulk versus Thor, Son of Asgard, what else is there? Doctor Strange, Iron Man, they're all, you know, it's like, do like DC, pick some of your big stories and give me an animated Civil War, give me an animated Secret Wars, Marvel Zombies.
Awesome.
That's the way to go.
That stuff would be great, but it kind of looks like the animated features are dead, because, I mean, Thor came in a long time ago. That was the last one, wasn't it?
Yeah, Thor, but it was also one of their worst ones.
Yeah, it was really awful. Yeah. Awesome.
And so they held that back to release in time with the movie as well. So.
Yeah.
Cool. All right. So there you go. There's Nicole.
Yeah. You check out Vomitus Volstagg.
Vomitus Volstagg. That's amazing.
Is that the voluptuous? He's vomitous this time.
I can kind of picture that. I've been playing Diablo 3, so I've got a lot of like hell and demons and dead stuff pictures.
This issue is so much fun. I'm not kidding. Sweet. If you have a favorite Asgardian, they're zombified. I love it. Even Sif looks pretty. Yeah.
Oh, did they call Sif like stiff or something? Because she's like a zombie.
Oh wow! Zing! Man, awesome. Okay, so I'm gonna call this a recommendation. It's right on the edge of like recommend to I don't know. I want you to imagine, if you will, a world in which the Dark Knight Returns trains an alternate reality Bruce Wayne, where his parents didn't die, but his dad was a complete bastard. And you would have Night Owl from the Before Watchmen set. So this is J. Michael Straczynski's attempt at a Night Owl story, mainly focused around the second Night Owl. Since the Minutemen sort of, you know, more focuses on the first. This is a very gritty, older Night Owl that's presented here. You know, lots of angry words and punching and grunting and guns and things.
And in a car in the shape of an owl.
A car in the shape of an owl, which seemed really out of place.
Owl
car. And then, you know, a young... the second Night Owl, as he's already very astute and detective like and, you know, discovers the Night Owl's, you know, real identity, and even meets him up and almost gets shot in the face because the first Night Owl
because
apparently he's a little paranoid. All things that don't seem very well. We talked about this as we wondered what this Before Watchmen was going to be like. And we had said that Darwin Cook was sort of like the holdout, you know, that he was the one that was like not really on board. And it seems to be that maybe that level of reverence and reservation has been applied to his books, because so far his two books have been the best. You know, his stuff has been the good stuff. It's not that this is bad. It's just it feels out of the world. Now, the context, the placement, everything, and there's good stuff and interesting stuff that happens in it. I don't even want to go through the whole thing. And there's a few sort of Watchmen-like points. Straczynski doesn't do a lot of work to try to feel like it's a part of the Watchmen world. That comes much more, I think, out of the Kubert's art than it does out of things.
I really like the art, though. I thought that it's...
Oh, yeah, and I think...
The books, this is the book where I felt like, okay, now this art feels like it fits Watchmen for me. I mean, the other books, you know, were great, you know? I mean, the art was fine in them, and they have their styles, but for some reason, this art just works really well for me for Watchmen.
Yeah, and I agree. I mean, I think the art in this is really good. I mean, it's really high-quality stuff. It's really doing a good job of telling story, and it does have a few of those Watchmen moments. One, there's a shot of... it's Dan, right? Dan is the second... His father has died, and he was a bit of a bastard. And, you know, his mother leans down like she's going to kiss him in the casket, and she actually spits on him. And the spit makes a tear, which is a really interesting image, but it really doesn't make any sense either, because it's sort of like it's spit making a tear, but why? Because it was just a... Anyway, it's like I get...
I didn't give this one as much time as I gave The Comedian, but it's like it still has a bit more to... Well, this issue, anyway, I don't know where the rest of it's going to go, but just like as a concept, it's got a little bit more to say than The Comedian did, because it's like we really know all we need to know about The Comedian, and last issue bore out the fact that there's really not much you can add to his backstory to change him or make him any more compelling than he already is. This one at least filled in an important part of the Night Owl's shared history and showed how it happened and how Dan became the second Night Owl and the whole Batman and Robin type relationship thing. You know, there was something to say there. I don't know what is gained with the whole parents thing. It seems a bit pat, a bit necessary, a bit of an old...
Yeah.
You know, it could be that I'm just a sucker, but I think that
Dan, you know, teaming up with Rorschach. I think that's pretty cool. I think it's gonna be kind of cool to see like early team
yeah,
up.
That's a, yeah, it's, showing how that
he goes crazy and he goes completely insane and they're buddies. It, I think that's gonna kind of be interesting to see.
It seemed a bit Deus Ex though, because I mean, it really, I mean, within the story, it wasn't like they met somewhere like on the same street and then
he
like
showed
had
up.
You know, he just showed up, you know, and it was like, okay, well, we're just going to do that then, you know, no kind of, you know, you've got several issues here, JMS, you could build it up, but no. And I'm a little concerned about the timelining of it. It's like,
it works for me because like when he shows up in the original story, what does he do? He just shows up in his apartment. So that kind of works for me.
Yeah. I guess what I'm wondering about or what I'm concerned about is like, I read this and I got to the end and I was kind of like, cool, I'm done.
Yeah, that's all of Night Owl that you need to see. That was like, their partnership started. I saw how that happened.
Yeah, I saw how it's like, everything else is in the original Watchmen. So I get to the end of it and I'm kind of like, But the reason I think I recommend it is because I think it's good for something to contrast like with the other before Watchmen, and the art is really good. So I think it's something interesting to read, but I mean, my initial pass is that I think Darwin Cook's sort of reverence to the original material is serving him well. I think the other writers, creators may be going a little bit off script, and while they may be exploring interesting things, I don't know how necessary or how well I feel like they fit within, you know, at least my vision, my superior vision.
None of it's necessary. That's the point of it.
Exactly. None of it's necessary. So, yeah. But anyway, check that out. Night Owl.
It still seems to me to be one of the better things Straczynski's managed for DC.
It is, and maybe that's the other reason I'm recommending it, is just because...
I mean, for God's sakes, Night Owl doesn't walk the earth and just talk to people. That's a plus in one
call. Well, and he also isn't trying to, like, he's not trying to deconstruct Night Owl either, you know?
I don't think it's physically possible to deconstruct Night Owl any more than Watchmen already does, you know?
Exactly.
Night Owl is himself a walking deconstruction.
So I think the work is already done. He can just play within the world, so.
And
anyway.
I think it still stands a bit above the comedian as well.
Oh, God, yeah, yeah. I mean, if I had to rank it, I would be like comedian and then this and then...
And Silk
Spectre and then Minutemen, yeah.
I've got them all except for Minutemen. They didn't send me a copy of Minutemen, so I'm waiting on a copy.
You got ripped off, sir.
I am sorry, but hey, you know what? Silk Spectre was pretty good.
Silk Spectre was good. We liked that as well. So
I didn't hate Comedian, but yeah, I see what you guys are saying about it.
It's not that it's badly written or anything. It's just that it has nothing to say.
Yeah.
I thought it was interesting, though, in the Comedian that he was a good friend with JFK, but in the movie he killed him. I thought that was kind of
well, but
the original Watchmen implies that he might have been there. And then one is just here to mess with you, basically.
That was kind of interesting, yeah.
You know, a thought that actually struck me about the comedian that kind of annoyed me after we were finished talking about it last time was the way that he's called in that story to help bring in Moloch, who they think is running drugs and prostitution. And I'm like, in Watchmen, in the Minuteman's headquarters, you see Moloch's evil solar weapon. Stop trying to impose weird modern ideals of what 1940s criminals would have got up to, and accept that even though nobody had superpowers in the Watchmen world, people still tried to do insane shit with solar weapons. Yeah. And they didn't call in superheroes to deal with a bit of drug running.
Right.
You know, it seems woefully just grim and, well, Azzarello-y noirish sort of. That guy had a... I don't know what the solar weapon did, but... Maybe we could have had that story.
That would have been fun.
Maybe that'll be in minute.
Yeah, probably. Okay, Chris McFeely, then. Round us out, sir.
Yes. I'm going to talk about Alan Moore's League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, Century 2009.
Cool.
For backstory. This is the third chapter of the... I guess what would be the fourth volume of League of Extraordinary Gentlemen. There was the original series, which was a mini-series, and collected into a graphic novel.
I'm surprised he's still putting these out, by the way. They come out, I'm always shocked, because I keep thinking, oh, he's got to be done with this, but no, then another one comes out. You know?
Well, I'll get through talking about this, and you might grasp why he says what he has to say here.
Yeah.
So there's the first series was a miniseries and then collected. The second series, miniseries, and then collected. The third volume is The Black Dossier, which was an original graphic novel. And then this, if you want to call it the fourth series, is made up of three, like, a small graphic novel sized. I'm not counting the pages, but they are something like 72, 74, 76, 80 type page mini graphics. It's a three-part story called Century, which begins in 1909, or is it 1910? And the second one is set in 1969, and this one is set in 2009. Now, it's hard to recommend anybody to just go out and grab this now, because although each one is its own story, they are overall like a complete narrative, which is essentially about Mina Harker and Alan Quatermain attempting to stop the rise of the Antichrist. As you do. Yes. Now, one of the tricks about the way the world of the League of Extraordinary Gentlemen has grown is that, you know, you read the first one, you see the film, or don't see the film, but if you see the film, you think it's just like
watch the movie, but if you have, I'm sorry.
Yeah, if you have to. It just seems like it's a bunch of fictional characters in there, classic like fictional characters from yore, and they're doing stuff. But really, as the world of the League has grown, it's become apparent that it is the world of all fiction. So, for instance, there is no Adolf Hitler in the world of the League of Extraordinary Gentlemen. But there was an Adenoid Hinkle, who was the great dictator from the Charlie Chaplin movie. There are allegories. There are assorted fictional allegories for all these world figures. So this story has been about Oliver Haddo, the League's version of Aleister Crowley, trying to raise the Antichrist. And when we last left our heroes in 1969, Oliver Haddo had transferred his spirit into the body of a man named Tom, who happened to teach at a school in...
I've heard about this. I know what you're going to say.
Yes. Yeah, Oliver Haddo transferred his soul into Voldemort at the end of the last one.
No, he did not!
Yes, he did. Yes.
Wow.
Voldemort was, had, he, Mina ran into Voldemort at a concert where Haddo was intending to transfer his spirit into the singer on stage. Now, the singer was a character Mick Jagger had played in a film that I can't remember the name of, but he was a really popular world figure. I mean, he could be really influential once Haddo got in there and carried out his evil deeds. But that was stopped. But Mina, it being the 60s, was tripping on acid at the time. And whenever she returned to her body after defeating Haddo in battle on the astral plane, she was still coming down and had a crazy hallucination of Dracula that tipped her over the edge and landed her in an insane asylum. That's where our story begins!
Wow.
Yes, Alan Quatermain and Orlando have gone their separate ways afterwards, and they need to find Mina and stop the rise of the Antichrist. And this has been blown all over news sites and everything with a little touch of outrage. So, well, let's put it this way. Haddo possessed Voldemort and went off to the school that he worked at, and, you know, there was a very magically talented, important young man at that school who would be a perfect candidate for such an endeavor. So the Antichrist is Harry Potter.
Yeah, I heard that.
Wow.
But they never actually...
Epilogue to Hermione and Ron and a bunch of other characters. Right? I think I've heard this.
Yeah, they all die. It's as easy as it goes. He destroys. Well, this is. I mean, they never name names, obviously, because they never name names of anything that's in the public domain. No problem with, but anything that's not, names are never named. Harry's scar has been the flesh where it was has been torn off. You know, and he's much older now. So, but he only appears at the end of the story after all our heroes have got. The simple story is Orlando goes and finds Mina. With the help of the British government, and they managed to convince Alan at the last moment to come back and help them stop the Antichrist. That is the long and the short of it. I don't want to tell you any more too specific in details. I was a little annoyed to discover how late in the story the revelation of the Antichrist came, when it had been all over the news sites anyway. But it's the fictional character, and I cannot blow this, so all I can say is this. The fictional character who appears to take him down might be the best, one of the best single things like League of Extraordinary Gentlemen has ever done.
Wow.
The fictional character that arrives, total deus ex machina, utterly unapologetic, implied it may be the literal deus in the machina, incarnated in the physical character who arrives to take down Harry the Antichrist.
Yeah, I imagine Alan Moore, that, you know, some young creator would come to him and say, will you read these and tell me what you think? And he would take them and he would set them down on the ground and he would grab some lighter fluid and he would hose them down and then he would light them on fire and then he would take his dick out and he would piss on them and he would just look at the person and then walk off.
So you're saying he would like him because he's putting the fire out, right?
I mean, that was the most respectful thing that he does.
Funny you should describe it like that, because throwing things in the street, lighting them on fire, and killing them with his dick are all things that Harry Potter the Antichrist does.
Awesome. Wow. And I know nothing about this, so.
I like this Harry Potter version of Harry Potter.
Little bit of the old penis as wand metaphor there, and he shoots lightning out of it.
Awesome.
Oh my god.
But more to the point.
Is penis as wand? Is that what you're saying?
Wow. There's metaphors at play, but more to the subtext of the whole thing, it is first. Well, okay, one thing I have always said, not so much with the first two League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, because they were classic characters of literature that pretty much everybody would know, you know. But from the Black Dossier upwards, the compound effect of reading in a League comic has been to leave you feeling very stupid, as you do not get the sheer mountain of references that are being heaped on. Because, like, where the first books really just deal with, here are the characters, and the first book is a bunch of literary characters: Mina Harker from Dracula, Alan Quatermain, King Solomon's Mines, the Invisible Man, Mr. Hyde, and Captain Nemo form a team that is caught up in a battle between Fu Manchu and Professor Moriarty. You're not at all. It's, you know, that's your high concept. You know, that's the league volume.
Pretty good. I like the first two. They're okay. But beyond that, I've not read any of them. I have no idea what happened after those.
And then volume two is the War of the Worlds, and the chemicals that they use to kill the Martians come from Dr. Moreau. It's as simple as that, you know. But it's when you hit the Black Dossier that suddenly the references just come in an unstoppable flood of stuff that you'll never get. Everything from the obscure British sitcoms to classics of Western literature and beyond. But anybody reading 2009 is liable to get more than they won't, because this is the popular culture of today. So once you get your prologue and you see Orlando walking through the streets of London, you know, you see posters for Aquaman 2, Revenge of Quisp, in a reference to Entourage. You know, you get a poster for Driveshaft, Charlie's band from Lost.
Lost,
Who Dat Ninja 3D from 30 Rock. Father Ted, Black Books, James Bond, the presidents from The West Wing and The 24 are mentioned. The countries that have appeared in those shows are just a lot of modern Harry Potter, of course, primarily. You'll get it. You won't feel as dumb. I mean, Orlando goes in one scene for help from MI. Well, they used to work for MI. MI5. Way back in the day, back in the original League, M is Professor Moriarty. M for Moriarty. And he's, you know, in the higher echelons of government. But they've been working for them ever since. And, Orlando goes to them for help. And they bring two men named J3 and J6 bring Orlando to M. And I'm like, I turn this page. This better be Judi Dench. And I turn the page and it's Judi Dench.
Okay. Very good.
And, you know, I'm happy with that. And then a couple of panels later, Judi Dench's M is an elderly Emma Peel.
Okay.
From the Avengers.
Wow.
The British adventure series, The Avengers.
Yeah. Now,
Emma Peel previously appeared in The Black Dossier when she was teamed up with James Bond to hunt down Mia and Allen in the 60s.
That's so great. That makes my head explode. Like, wow. When I think about on Her Majesty's Secret Service, that makes my head explode!
Well, you know, they make a couple of references here to how she found out that James Bond was... she finds out from the disgraced spy from Burn Notice that James Bond was responsible for
killing... Oh, my God!
Michael West tells them information.
Yeah. Please tell me Bruce Campbell shows up at some point.
Oh my gosh, that'd be even better.
Weston tells British intelligence that James Bond was assigned by the Americans to kill Emma Peel's father.
Fantastic.
Emma Peel has ensured that James Bond is, you know, he's 90-something now and in agony in his old age, but they keep him alive because it's the best thing they can do. But he's become an institution, so they have to employ these increasingly younger stand-ins to keep the propaganda going. And it's at that point that you realize that J3 and J6 are Roger Moore and Daniel Craig.
Oh, my God.
You know, and then later in the stories, all the other ladies from the Avengers who were John Steed's partners appear, and they say, we're all very loyal to each other. We love the same man. Stuff like that, you know. You know, I could go on and on about the number of references there in here, but the real meat, the interesting stuff, like, it's where it starts to become aware when AM starts to talk about increasingly younger stand-ins to keep the propaganda going. These characters, incidentally, are immortal. After bathing in the fountain from the novel She That Makes You Immortal, which happened sometime between century number one and the Black Dossier, they are immortal and have lived for nearly a century now at this point. And the world has changed around them. And you do feel like they are Alan Moore in this analogy. They are trapped in a world where entertainment... you see, the posters are for Aquaman 2 and Houdat Ninja 3D. And, you know, it's a world where entertainment is strung out and repetitive and has evolved into something that is grimy and... It's essentially what happens when the stories go wrong, you know. When they go on the train to Hogwarts, and you know, and they pass the corpses of Thomas the Tank Engine and Ivor the Engine on the way.
Oh my God!
You know, they there are some very direct rips on J.K. Rowling. You know, as the train just shoots off at a ridiculous speed, this what did you do? Make it go slower. I can't. There's only one speed. This is like a child's idea of how a train ought to work. And they arrive in they arrive in the village where Hogwarts is, and this whole environment seems artificial, as if it's been reconstructed out of reassuring imagery from the 1940s. And you know, there's a commentary about the idea is like that the landscape where Hogwarts is sort of England's dream time. It's the land that is shaped by the subconscious of England, and it's the fiction within the fiction. Because I mean, the League is the world of our fiction, the real world's fiction, and Hogwarts is, I mean, they never name names, as I say, but it's presented as being the world of fiction within the world of the League. And it's been destroyed by, you know, Harry Potter, the Antichrist, rampaging out of it years beforehand. And they question, you know, if our magical landscape, if our art and fairy tales and fictions, if that goes bad, maybe the material world follows. And, you know, this is Moore commenting on what he believes to be the state of the entertainment industry today. Because we're all very aware of Alan Moore's position on current entertainment.
Oh, yeah.
And Alan Moore is a crazy old man, and I hope he never changes.
Well,
you know what? No. Alan Moore is that old, like, great uncle that's still kicking around, that's a complete fucking bastard, and yeah. He's a racist, sexist asshole, but everybody tolerates him because he was a cool old man once, and maybe he fought in the war or something, you know? And he says crazy stuff, and everybody's like, what? And you're like, oh, he's an old man. He's going to die soon. Just
Let him do his thing, you know?
Well, I try to mentally separate the, or try to ignore the ramblings of the man from what he says in his work, but there are the points where you can see them meeting like this. I mean, this book is essentially Alan Moore's statement on the nature of popular culture and art and entertainment today, and he's presenting it as a reflection on the state of the world through like a three-layered system, if you will. You know, and he takes some pretty direct jabs at the architect of the biggest bit of prose fiction of the last decade, you know?
He's not doing anything to help the image that he hates women, is he?
Well, I don't think it matters that she's a woman. It's just her work that he's sort of attacking here. You know, and the story as a whole feels like it reaches an end point for the world of the League. Like, there's more you could do, but the story, it does feel like this could be, like, that's it from the League. If we never saw any more, he would have set his pace on the nature of entertainment in the here and now, and anything else would just be indulgent use of proving how well-read he was. Although, mind you, I tend to not believe, ever since the Black Dossier, I've doubt, you know, League 1, League 2, I could believe it. I think Alan Moore spends a lot of time on Wikipedia.
Yeah.
Because no one man could possibly know all the stuff that is in all of these books, you know. And I realized that in the Black Dossier when they made a reference to James Bond Jr. And I was like, there's no way Alan Moore knew that. There's no way Alan Moore knew about the shitty 1980s cartoon spin-off.
Are you kidding? That cartoon was awesome. Don't talk about that. No, it was shit. That was shit.
Yeah. it was so bad Triplett couldn't even keep the joke going. That's how bad it was.
they'd had James Bond in the book. They couldn't call him James Bond. They'd call him just Jimmy. And they wanted to make a reference to Felix Leiter, who was the American spy from I forget which Bond film he was in. But they couldn't call him.
He's in
Leiter.
Several.
Well, there you go then. So they had to call him F. Gordon Leiter. And Gordon is the name of Leiter's son, who appeared in the James Bond Jr. cartoon. And I knew that.
I didn't even know that.
That was one of those moments. Those are plenty. Not so much with this one, because there's a lot in the signal-to-noise ratio or the amount of stuff that you immediately recognize versus the stuff you don't that's right there on the page rather than hidden away in the depths of the background is much greater. But it was one of those moments where I was able to go, ah, see what you did there. You know, actually figured it out. There's a couple of references to things like Fireball XL5 and figuring out that Emma Peel's father, the respected industrialist John Knight, was responsible for founding Knight Industries, stuff like that.
Oh my god.
Wow.
Now that's Knight with no K. But whenever they take a tour of Knight Industries during the Black Dossier, you see them working on a talking autonomous vehicle.
Hmm.
It's chitty chitty bang. But it lays the groundwork.
Oh my god. Wow.
So it's like those are the moments that allow you to feel smart or at least feel in on the joke. And that was, you know, to sum up, rambling on an awful lot about this. This one, hard to recommend in isolation because it is the third act of a story, but it's also easily the most punchy, fast-moving, and rewarding one of the three century books because it is the resolution. And it also feels a lot less exclusive in its use of modern culture to an under-read, inbred idiot like me. Who doesn't get all the stuff that Alan Moore normally does.
I saw this on Comixology. I think all of them are on Comixology now.
Yeah, I might have to check that out.
I might check it out myself.
Well, that was a...
You should check the Black Dossier out as well because it came out third and then Century followed, but the Black Dossier occurs in the 50s between the first and second installments of Century, and they do leaguer. I don't know how much you need it for the story purposes. I mean, the meeting with Emma Peel and James Bond is in the Black Dossier, and it factors into the events of this one. You'll probably just be more in on the references, but you're going to want to set a week aside if you want to read the Black Dossier.
Wow.
Like, literally, the trick with the Black Dossier is that it's the book you're holding is also, like, the story is about them going to look for this book called the Black Dossier, which contains all these secret documents and everything, but also the book that you are holding and reading is the Black Dossier, and there's comic pages of their adventures, but in between them are all the documents of the Black Dossier, like, you know, a lost Shakespeare folio that shows how the Queen founded MI15 back in the Shakespearean times with Basildon Bond and the descendants of Bond and M and Sherlock Holmes. And a never before seen Jeeves and Wooster extract that detailed the rising of those dashed annoying old ones during a garden party. And Jack Kerouac novels following up the Fu Manchu stuff, Tijuana Bibles. All sorts of stuff.
It sounds like I could go insane just reading this comic. Is it worth my sanity to check this out?
That's just the Black Dossier I'm describing. It is, you'd have to put some effort in to read the Black Dossier. I think it's fairly rewarding in the end, but there's a lot of stuff in there, and it's like all of the non-comic pages, the bits from the dossier are prose, so you know there's a lot of reading in it too. But it will inform and... inform a reading of Century, so I would generally encourage to read the Black Dossier before trying Century. But for Century as a three-parter, like this one definitely caps it off and makes the whole thing worthwhile. It's kind of all riffed on the Three Penny Opera as well. The first volume in particular was the Three Penny Opera with Pirate Jenny and Mac the Knife and all the rest of it, and echoes of that run all the way through it. Yeah, I could ramble on about all the weird little things, and suffice it to say, it's worth a read.
I hope so at this point.
It's worth a read.
This is a recommendation. This is a recommendation, right?
So that's what I'm taking. So okay. So basically, Chris Mafili did a full review of every book of League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, and we're gonna do a recommendation of More Than Meets the Eye.
That's just because this is the capstone of the whole thing. Well, since the third book, it's the capstone of all that. So I got away from me there. Sorry about that.
That's okay. We'll work on your definition of review and recommend. But anyway,
it's good to have the background.
I'm beginning to think maybe I didn't give enough information now.
So yeah,
just kidding.
Chris Triple, you were fine. You were okay. So we now have like 5 minutes to talk about More Than Meets the Eye.
Hey, this is awesome. All right, call it a day.
It is awesome. This book definitely pulls into... I'll run through this as quickly as I can, I guess, while we talk about how awesome it is. This opens up with Rung sitting with Fort Max, who has been ordered to subject himself to psychoanalysis since he's, you know, not stable.
Really, really glad, because you remember I was talking about how I wasn't sure, like, what I was supposed to think about that, and how everybody was going, "Woo, yeah, isn't it awesome?" And I'm like, "Yeah, but you objected when Optimus Prime capped that dude," and I'm like, "I'm really glad to see that they didn't just have that be a thing that he did and then move on from there." So this had me from the first thing, and I was like, "Right, good, I like this, yeah."
It's also probably good if you've read Last Stand of the Wreckers. That ties in pretty heavily to this issue as well. So if you haven't read this, go read Last Stand of the Wreckers. If you haven't read Last Stand of the Wreckers, what the hell is wrong with you? But
I think they do a pretty good job of telling this story in a way that it stands on its own, though.
Sure.
I mean, it does lead to essentially a massive narrative coincidence when you reach the final page.
Yeah.
But the last stand stuff is just there at the start to make that last page work without you having to read Last Stand.
But there's, there's the typical stuff I really like that's done in here. There's one scene where, you know, they have, Rung has Ultramagnus laying on like a bed, you know, in front of him so that he's talking and relaxed. And he's asking him about what happened at Garrus 9. And you have a split panel where you have Overlord on one side torturing him and trying to get information out of him.
Did you say Ultramagnus? You didn't see
it. No, I meant Fort Maximus. I'm sorry. Fort Maximus. Sorry.
Yeah. I've caught everybody talked about this issue.
Yeah. So we've got Fort Maximus on a table.
You've got Overlord on one side trying to extract information from him. You have Rung on the other side who's trying to ask him what happened. And just a beautiful sort of parallel of both concept and idea, and, you know, and the different things happening at those times. So really interesting on that. actual Ultramagnus does find out about the bar in this thing and arrests poor Swerve. And so there's a whole sequence that takes place in the bar, and you have several of the Autobots. In particular, Chrome Dome, who can recognize an Autobot by the sound of their transformation. As this he's doing as like a bar trick.
Dolls. This is this is the best stuff. Like all of these interactions like this, just these guys hanging around, just swapping stories and pulling out their party pieces.
Yeah, you know, little bar.
It's a good place to come
party
in.
Party tricks and
I
stuff.
Trailbreaker was. I'm so cool. I've got guns in my legs.
Yeah, oh, God, that's in the
yeah, that was great.
The line of the comic.
You got guns in your legs. That's so awesome.
Yeah, it was totally that moment where that dude that you've been talking bad about walks in. And, like, you end up saying all the things that you just said were lame, like they're cool, because you don't know what else
great,
to say.
The great thing, like, that's a great funny moment in and of itself, but it's such a great way of actually doing something with Trailbreaker for the first time in 28 years.
Yeah.
Like, all Trailbreaker has ever been known for is if you need a force field, you get that bloke in. It's like any time in the cartoon when somebody would go, you, and Trailbreaker, and you go, this plot's going to require a force field at some stage. Yep. He's not bringing him along because he knows he needs a force field, but the writers decided to bring Trailbreaker along because there's going to be a colossal explosion or an island that needs shielding or something. And it's the only reason Trailbreaker was in Spotlight Cup, for instance. So, like, Roberts is taking that and actually making it that Trailbreaker really resents the fact that all he's ever known for and all he's ever brought along for is for having a force field, and he's making him he gets a little drink in him and he's like, oh, suck. He's resentful of the
this comic gets you to like characters that you never thought you would like, you know.
But The thrust of this issue takes place as basically a hostage situation, because after the whole sort of there's a mini exchange here with Trailbreaker, and then Ultramagnus like shoots like five or six people in the bar.
Fortress Max.
I'm sorry, God
Fort
damn
Max.
It, Fort Max. Oh God. All right, if I say Alt Mag, just you know what I meant.
I think you've got some unresolved issues with Ultramagnus.
I
so
do,
maybe you
really.
Need to go
what,
visit Run, you know?
God,
JD,
maybe I should...
Why do you hate Ultramagnus?
I don't know. But there's a great... Actually, I will talk about the Ultramagnus deal, because Tailgate shows up, and they're asking if he's going over the unabridged version of the stuff, and there's a bit of a conversation there. And then all of a sudden, Tailgate perks up, and he's like, wait a minute! There's an abridged version?
Yeah.
Which is awesome. Anyway.
I'm still campaigning for a Swerve Tailgate, you know, a little spotlight meeting.
God, yes.
So want that.
So,
every issue of this is a spotlight
meeting. Here's where the thrust of this issue takes place. Fort Max shoots these people in the face, then goes to Rung's office, holds Rung and Whirl, of all people, hostage. As he's in the middle of a flip-out, of which he sort of knows that he's in the middle of a flip-out, but he doesn't really know what to do about it. So it's like, this is what he's trying to do about it, but he doesn't really know why. Meanwhile, you've got Rodimus, Ultramagnus, Drift on the outside, and Blaster on the outside, trying to figure out not only what's going on in the room, but how they're going to, you know, settle the situation down.
Whirl is so good in this.
Oh my God, he's amazing. Oh my God, yeah. He's totally like the reverse psychology in this, because you can tell he's scared shitless, and he is beat to fuck. He's been stabbed and punched in the face several times, and all he does is keep egging. He just keeps egging Fort Max on.
I don't think it's reverse psychology. Like, Whirl wants to die.
Maybe that's it, too.
No,
yeah,
I mean, it's pretty
really,
messed up.
It immediately clicked with me as, like, remember back in the first issue when Whirl was going to burn down that shack of bodies? I don't think Whirl was going to leave that check.
You think he was going to burn it down with him in it? Wow.
I think so. Because, I mean, he is just, you know, he's. You think maybe he's going for the reverse psychology at the start just to get in his head. But when Max has the friggin' barrel of the gun heating up at the end of the comic, it's like, do it, you coward, do it, shoot me. Like, Whirl wants to die.
Yeah.
Do you blame him? Whirl's been through a hell of that.
Yeah, and he even tells a lot of his backstory in this as well.
Yeah.
What do you think about the little comment where he's like, so, oh, so now you're going to tell me what I want to know? It says, well, you threatened a friend. That kind of surprised me.
And even Rung was like, what? There's a great part in here where they start getting audio. The Rodimus and the Autobots on the outside start getting audio, and they can't figure out from where. Well, and it was mentioned several issues back that Rung has a recording device built into his thumb.
I think
which
it was issue two, wasn't it?
Yeah, which Fort Max finds and removes.
Yeah, and not the most gentlest of ways.
Yeah, I love, and of course it happens off panel, which I'm fine with in this instance because you have plenty of text in which Rung's like, no, it's deep seated. No, you don't. Ooh, yeah. Meanwhile, back on the ranch, Ratchet and First Aid are trying to fix up the robots that got shot in the face. And this is another brilliant moment of letting pictures help tell the story. And that's what I love in comics. It's like, pretty panels are cool, but it's when you can use those panels to actually, like, give the audience the aha moment in which they're talking, and Ratchet's like, you know, everybody keeps saying random, but something's not sitting right with me, you know? It just seems weird, because these guys were standing near somebody else, and he didn't shoot them, but he did shoot this other guy. And he's like, you know, sometimes to figure it out, you just need to take a step back and look. And when they pans back, you see all four of them laying out, and you notice they're all the same color. And it's all that same blue as Overlord. And it's like,
yep,
aw shit. It's perfect.
It sucks to eat pipes.
Yeah. But, and I don't really... I don't want to go too far into it. Like I said, we get a lot of Whirl's backstory. And they devise a plan.
Just simply the great thing about Whirl's backstory is when you realize that Roberts has basically seeded the entirety of Whirl's story through everything he has written for IDW yet.
Yeah.
It's in Bullets. It's in Last Stand. It's in Chaos Theory. It's all in there.
Yeah. Yeah, it's great. I mean, it's a great movement. You know, through that as well, and interesting,
like,
for Whirl.
I shouldn't be amazed at this point, because, like, this book is consistently good, but every time an issue comes out, I'm so amazed that I'm reading a Transformers comic, and it's getting old in this, but
what,
it's...
Well, what's, like, amazing is that you look forward to reading a Transformers comic.
Yeah. But to move
in
towards...
In some cases, I read this before I read anything else that I want to read.
I read this last.
Oh, usually the first.
I am
read...
at the point where I need to move this to the end of my
I am reading
because
it
because I read this
yeah.
first this week, and then I had to read Thor.
Yeah.
And I was like, this is not... Oh, no,
I knew...
You know, I'm not saying that More Than Meets the Eye is necessarily the best thing I'm reading or the best comic on the stands. I'm a little uncomfortable saying that because as a rabid Transformers fan, I realize my perceptions of this book are warped, you know. But it's still a very good comic by any definition, whether or not it's... I mean, I'm not saying it's necessarily the best thing. Is it better than Journey into Mystery, Avengers Academy? I'm not sure. I'm not sure about these things. But all I know is that as a Transformers fan, my head is left swimming when I get to the end of an issue like this.
Yeah.
And I have to pick up something like Thor. It's like Thor's fighting creatures that make your nightmares real for the fourth issue in a row.
Yeah.
And I'm like,
yeah, that's why
I should
Marvel
go
Zombies.
And take, I should go take a walk or something.
But I mean, it's just good stuff. But so I'm gonna move real quick towards the end here. But like I said, I won't blow the end for anybody. But meanwhile. Swerve and Rewind are have been put on rivet duty, so they're on the outside of the ship, you know, tightening rivets basically. And you find out that, well, we know why Swerve is there, but you find out that, and this may have been revealed too, or some bit of it anyway.
No, this was pretty much.
Is this new? Because I thought that there was at least some bit where, like,
they mentioned the data discs at one point, but not what was on them.
Not what was on them. Correct.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so
with And like, was it the first issue he had the discs?
Yeah, he bought the discs in the first issue. Red Alert said he found them in the last issue.
So we find out that Rewind, even though he tries to protest otherwise, apparently into snuff videos.
Nah, see, I don't believe he's protesting. Or, like, he says he doesn't watch him for pleasure or professionally. Something's going on there. He's not watching them for fun.
Yeah, it's just a little odd. It's kind of an odd thing.
He's a historian, and he's having to, you know, take the good and the bad.
Yeah, but that would be professional capacity as well. Right. Like, there's something more to it than that, you know?
I don't know if it's like sparks exiting or something. I don't know. There's something else.
All sorts from the sounds of it.
But
there's a story there. That's the great thing about it.
Oh,
there's something.
One of the next things we hear about, I think.
Yeah.
Rodimus,
I can't wait.
Rodimus has, since they're on the outside of the ship, he wants them to go to the window at Rung's office and use their rivet gun like a laser to shoot Fort Max. And that's all I'm going to say about that.
Fort Max calls Rodimus Hot Rod, and he doesn't like it.
Oh, man, he does, too.
Oh, that was
and there's a great
awesome.
Part
I
in here. Because what Fort Max wants is he wants Rodimus to turn the ship around and head back to Cybertron. And there's a great another world great line in there where he's like, where Fort Max gives him his demands, and he's like, oh, you screwed up, man. Because Rodimus, he's always going to do whatever you don't want him to. If you would have told him, don't go to Cybertron, whatever, then maybe he would have turned around. But now that you told him to go there, he's definitely not going to do that. But, there's a bit of a shocking sort of event there that I won't mention. I don't want to spoil for you. But I will say that the end of this references back to something that I had mentioned and was not completely put down, but, you know. We end with Red Alert. There's a bit of an epilogue to this story. And a mention of where the heck is Red Alert. And Red Alert mentioned several issues ago that he kept hearing these voices coming from what should be below the ship completely. And so he pulls the drill off of one of the dead... What were those called that are stuck
Duobots.
In the Duobots, the drill off
Duobots?
Of one of them?
Was that or?
Or.
And uses it to drill a hole in the floor and actually peeks through into what looks like a holding area below the ship.
I did not see that coming.
No.
Well,
I mean,
there were two things I didn't see coming. Basically,
well,
you know, that
I didn't see
thing,
that.
We're not gonna talk
now
about.
We mentioned several issues ago, and I'll go ahead and talk about this part of it, where he had the actual recording, and the recording was saying "me kill, me kill, me kill," and I suggested, that it might be the other way around. It might be "kill me, kill me."
It's almost a triple bluff. Because it's like you look at it and you think, well, that's saying kill me. Obviously, that's somebody under there. And then you think, oh, wait, no, hang on. Because we know Grimlock's coming up in this comic later. Mm-hmm. So it might actually be the way it appears. Meek, it might be a double bluff. You know, you think it's supposed to say, you think that it's supposed to be read the opposite way, but it's really supposed to be written the way that it is written. So it's a double bluff. But it's actually a triple bluff because it is the first thing you did it for.
Right.
But it's not good.
Yeah. And what it is wow. I mean, that's the other thing that we're not going to mention here, but
you can't.
I had to go back through the comic actually and kind of, I was like, did I miss something when I saw that?
I had to
go back and look, and I was like, oh, okay.
I do want to go back. What I really want to do is have a note card on my desk or a list on a, because I need the list of the prophecy things from the first issue. That's like, don't go here, don't look at this, don't talk to these people.
Well, one of them is don't look in the basement.
Well, there you go.
There's one of them. Yeah.
Well, maybe, but back in the first couple of pages, Overlord talks about something hidden beneath Aquitas, which is already down in the bottom levels of Garrus 9. Is that the basement?
Torturing Fort Max.
So there's another potential basement, and the other one is don't look in the coffin, and we got somebody who could go in a coffin now. It's like
this
one of the.
This is so good. I love this comic.
This is just good
one
stuff.
Another one of the ones was don't go to Delphi. And it's like, well, they were at Delphi already, and it all turned out okay, really. Oh, and then Fortress Maximus went crazy, started killing a bunch of people. That turned out pretty bad. Is that why they shouldn't have gone to Delphi? Or is it the fact that the Decepticon Justice Division operate within Delphi territory, and we know they're turning up next issue, and what's going to come off the back of that?
It's
and
so
we think the Decepticon Justice Division are coming for Drift because, you know, and, you know, they've been made aware of the Lost Light because of their trip to Delphi. But then the end of this issue comes along, and it's like, well, they'd probably want that more than they would want Drift, and it's like,
I don't know, but it's awesome. That's all I know. It is so good. So definitely, if you have been on the fence,
buy this comic.
And saying, I have read Transformers comics before and I didn't like them, you know, this is not those. This is actually good stuff. So,
now, didn't a trade come out with the first, was it five issues or four issues already?
It's the death of Optimus Prime and the first three issues, the Liar's A to D storyline.
Okay, I was going to say, like, if the trade came out, buy the trade and get this one, but no, it doesn't have all of them. Just buy the trade and get the issues.
Four and five as well, yeah.
So check it out. More than meets the eye. This was issue six. So, I mean, you can't jump on here. You got to go get the other issues. I mean, you really need to read it all because there's a lot of stuff that's being, you know, seeded and planted through. But you will thank us so much that you did that. You will, like, come back. You will send us emails and tweets, and you'll be like, oh, my God, Fanboy Versus was totally right. This is amazing. You know.
The thing is, a lot of my friends won't read this because they don't like Transformers. I'm like, if you just like a good story, just read it.
Story.
You don't need to be a Transformers fan.
Yeah,
That is really one of the best things. Like, just like as More Than Meets the Eye number one, it's easy to overlook Transformers fans, but the way More Than Meets the Eye number one is written is really, it really highlights how the fact that there are loads of these guys. And it's not just 1984 and 1985. There are loads of these guys. And no, everybody doesn't know everybody else. So More Than Meets the Eye number one is about people who don't know each other meeting for the first time and coming together. And they're all, excuse me, they're introduced to each other as they are introduced to the reader. Even if you don't know your Transformers, you really can start with More Than Meets the Eye number one.
And you know, the page in the back is great for new readers. Meet the crew.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yep, and you get that every issue. You can find out who the characters are. I mean, even if you haven't read the issues before, which I wouldn't recommend, read them first, you've still got kind of like, okay, this is who your characters are.
Yeah.
And that's kind of cool. I mean, most comics don't do that. That's really neat.
Remember when Marvel used to have those fold-out covers and they would have that in there?
Yep.
Yep.
And then they would have to pay somebody to actually do that. And then now they just have those terribly written little previously on pages that the editor copy-pastes together from the same paragraphs that are shared amongst all the other event books that are happening, unless your Journey into Mystery.
Right.
Which those are awesome.
Recap pages. Like, recap pages, they're almost, like, unilaterally terrible, except for Journey into Mystery. Like,
yeah.
Deadpool I can't think of the word I want to use, introduced those way back in the late 90s. And everyone was like, damn, those be awesome. And then it was off the back of that, really, that they added those fold-out covers with the previous Leons.
Mm-hmm.
And they were good. And then basically, like, all I can assume is they got greedy and they kept the fold-out covers. But then there would be a double-page ad inside the fold-out cover, and the previous Leon would just be included on the single page of the facing sheet when you opened the comic. And then they got rid of it entirely.
Bastards.
Yeah. Just to digress for a moment.
So there you go. That's our show. Quick reminder again. July 14th, San Diego Comic-Con's coming up. And don't forget to, you know, if you got someone going, oh my gosh, there's some decent Transformers and G.I. Joe swag there as well.
And
I don't know about
My Little Pony.
And I don't know about the My Little Pony stuff. But I know
this
is going to be...
Derpy.
Derpy, there you go.
Derpy.
I did see that.
This is going to be your only, or one of the least, your only shots to get the Cliffjumper Terracon in the first edition mold in really awesome packaging.
I would love to have that.
Yeah, and this is also going to be your first chance to get the Bruticus in the G1, or in the game colors, I think, isn't it?
I may have... I may have made a mistake, actually. I already pre-ordered it, except for I'm getting the G2-ish looking colored ones, which I think looks pretty awesome, actually. So I'm happy with that.
So that's gonna be $100, you know, for the Bruticus. So plus there's the G.I. Joe crossover-ish Transformers tank thing, because apparently they figured out the way to sell G.I. Joe is to put Transformers on it.
Yeah.
I like G.I. Joe anyway.
Oh. So, reminder for those of you in the States, 4th of July is Wednesday. And so you may want to check with your local comic shop, you know, and see what their hours are going to be. I know my shop said that they're probably closing early. So I'm going to need to get down there early, get your stuff. So if you want stuff on Wednesday, check with your local shop, make sure you're going to get that stuff. If you do digitally, well, screw you, you're gonna be fine. And if you're in other parts of the world, also screw you. No. No, but yeah, it's going to be 4th of July week in the United States, so that's going to be Wednesday. It's our annual celebration of kicking British ass. So, because who doesn't love doing that?
I like to think of it as Amazing Spider-Man Day, because I will be seeing it on the 4th.
Ah, very good. Yep, and yes. Again, don't forget to see Amazing Spider-Man. We'll be talking about that next week.
I've got 8 hours. Yay!
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 So, I'm going to be seeing it next Sunday. I've already got plans with a buddy of mine, so... I'm going to be seeing it right before the show, so it'll be fresh in my mind as we discuss.
I'll be seeing it Wednesday as well.
Very nice. So, all right, we have gone way too long. I guess you need.
It's my fault. I should not have come back.
It is not your fault at all. We blame A1 Chris McFeely.
I think that was me. Yep.
Very excited about what is probably a good comic. It's at least worth a discussion. So, yeah, I may actually read it. I may read it just for the discussion bit. So. But anyway, that's our show. Thanks so much for joining us. And please tune in next time when it'll be Fanboy Versus.
This has been Fanboy Versus. Visit us at tfradio.net for show notes and to subscribe to the podcast. Follow us on Twitter at tfradio for news and updates. Like the podcast? Leave us feedback on iTunes. Copyright 2011, Radio Free Cybertron.